In October of 1940, German soldiers walled off a 1.5-mile section of Warsaw. They crammed it with Jews from Warsaw and central Poland to cut them off from the general population. Before the war, Jews made up as much as 70% of the population in some towns and villages. By April of 1942, half a million people lived in the small ghetto. This became a breeding ground for disease, and many people died from starvation. 83,000 had already died of hunger. Around 1,500 Jews living in the ghetto died each week from starvation and illnesses. Resettlements had sent 350,000 Jews to human extermination camps like Treblinka. Only a tenth of the Jews that were originally placed in the Warsaw Ghetto remained at this point, many of whom were too ill or malnourished to function normally. To make matters worse, mistreatment by the German soldiers and a constant fear of being deported loomed upon the remaining inhabitants of the Warsaw Ghetto almost daily. Edina Blady Swager, a pediatrician, killed her young patients with morphine rather than watching them be marched to the gas chambers and killed there. Marek Edelman, one of the leaders of the resistance, saw a passing policeman shoot a trio of children sitting in a line outside a hospital, his single bullet killing all three of them. At this point, the Nazis had been deporting about 6,000 Jews a week to the death camps. The Jews had had enough. They formed the ZOB, which was the Jewish Fighting Organization. Mordechai Anilewicz, at age 24, was the chief resistance commander. The ZOB gathered as many weapons as they could, but despite their efforts, the amount of weapons they had limited the number of fighters to about 700. Aaron Carmi watched as nearly all his family was taken away to Treblinka. He saw his brother get shot by German soldiers. His father saved him by pushing him out of one of the death trains. He wanted revenge. He prepared for the uprising for 3 months, creating bunkers, secret passageways, mines, and homemade grenades. The January before the uprising, resistance fighters fired upon German troops that were taking a group of Jews to the Umschlagplatz, the deportation point, showing that they will no longer be obedient to German commands. Combat only came when we knew that deportation meant death, reasoned Vladka Mead, a survivor of the war. This caused the Germans to tread much more cautiously in the ghetto. However, this was merely the eye of the storm, as the worst was yet to come. On April 19, 1943, the police and SS forces entered the ghetto. Led by General Jürgen Strupp, 2,054 German soldiers came prepared with tanks and flamethrowers. Initially, he dubbed it the Grand Operation, since it was supposed to be a 3-day cleanup to finish off the remaining Jews in the ghetto. He soon realized that this was not the case, as a tally after the first day of battle revealed a dozen dead Germans. This was the first urban uprising in German-occupied Europe. There was a frenzy of bullets, exploding mines, Molotov cocktails, and the cries of fury. The band of resistance fighters, with their small pile of pistols and homemade bombs, were facing large tanks and machine guns. Since they were unable to capture the fighters who fled over rooftops or utilized other escape routes after each clash, the Nazis decided to burn the ghetto, building by building. German Stukas dropped incendiary bombs on the ghetto, and the ghetto burst into flames. "I saw a world of fire and smoke," said Vladka Mead, a survivor of the war. General Strupp, the leader of this Jewish cleanup, said, "It was not unusual for Jews to remain in the burning houses until the heat and their fear of being cremated forced them to jump from the upper floors. They did so after throwing mattresses and other upholstered items into the street. With broken bones, they still tried to crawl across the street into housing blocks that had not yet been set on fire." On May 8th, German soldiers shot poison gas into the ZOB headquarters. Some of the resistance members inside decided to commit suicide rather than fall into the German soldiers' hands. One man shot his mother, his sister, and then himself. The last few days of the uprising, German soldiers utilized sound detection devices and dogs to find the Jews' hiding places. On May 16th, General Strupp wrote, "The Jewish quarter of Warsaw is no more." Afterward, he blew up the great synagogue on Flomoka Street outside the ghetto. This symbolized that the Jews of the city no longer existed. The Germans officially estimated that in a month's fighting, they killed or deported more than 56,000 Jews. Germans lost 16 soldiers and 85 were wounded, although many resistors believe the figures were much higher. Of the 700 resistance fighters, between 60 and 70 made it out. Only 6 of them are believed to be alive today. Other survivors were recruited by Germans to clean up the ghetto. Moritz Weisgrod was on a work detail that picked bodies up from the streets and later printed death announcements for 2 slices of bread apiece. Beata Chomotowska is restoring the memory of the Warsaw Ghetto in the city's Mirino neighborhood, which is built on the rubble of the former Jewish quarter. This area is still dead 68 years after the Germans destroyed it, she said. She has created a website to educate residents about the history of the place where they live, since new housing was often built on mounds of ruins that could not be cleared, eradicating all physical reminders of the former Jewish neighborhood. The Warsaw Ghetto Uprising has come to symbolize the bravery and faith that led many to stand up against the evil of the Nazis. It was the resistors' courage and refusal to accept the tyranny of their oppressors that brightened this tragic period in world history. Aaron Carmi remarked that Hitler wanted to destroy us at the roots, unto the third generation. We built a home and a family, and have continued the cycle in the tradition of Israel. That is the best revenge. Masha Putermilch, a fighter in and survivor of the uprising, said, "We are the last of our generation that saw firsthand and can tell the story. If we don't tell the story, history will forget us."